a group of fantastic panelists here. I think my role is just to introduce them, and each of you will have up to 5 minutes to speak. Please use your timer so you don't eat into the time of the next person. And then after that, we're going to open the floor to ask some questions to these plenary members. The first person I'm going to introduce is Ms. Widad Salim. And if you were here yesterday, Widad, you also did another presentation. So thank you for coming back today to share your work with us. So Widad is a community leader, but also she's a health promotion worker and works extensively in the community with women groups, especially in the Southeast. Widad's connection and commitment to the community is something that is well known. And she works with women at the grassroots level. She supports lots of our young people. And I think as a mother herself, she was here yesterday with her son, always here again today. And you know, this is what it is to be an African mother. It doesn't mean that the fathers are not helpful, but it's a very strong part of our identity. So I just want to say thank you, Widad, because you are leading by example. And what we try to also do is that we are refusing that our children are barriers to our success. And I think this is, you know, you are showing leadership in action, and I think Juanita did exactly that earlier on. So can we put our hands together for Widad, please? The next woman we have is Ms. Selva. She's got an interesting story always to tell. And yesterday, if you were on the panel or you were in this room yesterday, you would have heard Selva speak. And Selva shared personal stories where she's a woman who is inspiring us through her own work, but also through the work that she is doing, especially for marginalized youth. We tend to forget that we've got lots of our brothers and sisters and our children who are falling off the trace or off the track. Sometimes it's because of us. Sometimes it's because of the society. But regardless, we still have to hold their hand and we have to lift them up. So can we put our hands together, because this is a woman. And if you heard about the Black Rhinos, you've seen them on television, she is the brains behind it. So
can I just say something very quickly? Sorry, Jamie, can you stand up? He is the founder of the Black Rhinos.
And Jamie has an interesting story. Then we've got Miss Desiree Ashite. Desiree is part of our youth committee, and she has been instrumental in shaping and contributing to the success of the summit. I think nobody would doubt the presence of youth at the summit. Is that true? If you think it is true, clap your hands. The presence of our youth in the summit is because people like you are showing what you really love doing. But outside your community leadership, engagement, and mentoring other youth, Desiree has a master's in public health sciences. So she started a business called Awos Kitchen, where she promotes African food, especially West African food from Ghana. So put our hands together for Ms. Ashiti. And next we have the fabulous Nkandu Bells, all the way from Perth. Nkandu is one of those inspiring young women that when you see her, like when you read about her and you read and you see what she's done without knowing her, you think that it is some woman in her 60s or 70s. Then when you see her, you're like, oh my God, that's Nkandu Bells. She's an author, she has a background in journalism, she's a community leader. But what I like about you, Nkandu, is your motivational speaking. So can we put our hands together? And last but not least is Mr. Eshetu Damitu Tefara from the Ethiopian Embassy. Mr. Eshetu is a diplomat. Yesterday we had to have Ambassador Tifu. You know, her husband is back home, and after a year, he was arriving, and he was arriving yesterday, and he was scheduled. But you know, the diplomat has kindly stepped into his shoes We heard him deliver her speech this morning, but you are also sitting there to support us and your inspiration, because we need what we call a his for she's. Is that correct?
Yes.
The men champions of change. And sitting on this panel with these powerful women is something that we really want to applaud. So thank you, and can we put our hands together? This plenary is in health and well-being because of the various backgrounds that you people have. And I just wanted people to have a focus on, you know, what is health, but how do you link it to the cultural aspects? And what does it mean for you as a woman who is working in the community in that space? Thank you.
Healthy is not just, you know, being healthy, or it is not the absence of a disease. I mean, I can give you, you know, thousands of examples that I came across in the last 15 years, individuals who went through many diagnosed facilities and examinations, and they don't have any illness as such, but they are still not well. They say that I am sick, and sometimes it is because their family is stuck in Ethiopia, in one particular case, and the immigration system couldn't help them. And they couldn't work it out. It was just going round and round. And this has made the person very sick. And there is an ATOA chart example how everything is linked with health and being with well-being. I can say that example. A child was injured at the dump, near to the dump where he lives, and then taken to the hospital. And then it was asked why the child was playing near to the dump or this garbage area. That was because his mom could not afford more suitable housing because she was unemployed. So that economic situation can impact on the exposure to injury. And then why she is not really have the money or the resources to pay for a better area to live in a rent, that was because she has depression or mental illness that she had to cope with. Therefore, she was unable to work full time. And that's one example. In another area, that the access to employment, for example, going through discrimination and a whole lot of barrier as women settling in a new country. And that can, again, contribute to well-being. So we can't look at issues isolatedly, you know, in isolation. Everything is linked together. So we need to think more holistically. And we need to have an understanding, because it is a burden in health system in Australia for someone to go through all these examinations of expensive facilities, and yet this person doesn't even have any diagnosis or illness. I mean, it's really pathetic, and then no one is actually reaching the conclusion this needs to be addressed, and what is this person's issue exactly, why this person is suffering, and so on. And also, it needs to be addressed in different levels, in policy level, it needs to be addressed in educating individuals that this is the situation. You know, people need to understand what's going on with them, like they are not really have any diagnosis or sicknesses, but what's contributing to ill health is something else, and what else they can do about it. So it has to be done in different levels. For example, I can give you FGM issues, which is affecting 3 million girls in the world, according to World Health Organization. 3 million girls are at risk every year. And 28 countries in Africa traditionally practices FGM. And in Australia, we have come a long way. Now we have a national education kit that people can access online. But that was done because we have stood strong in advocacy, and policies have been developed to address the issue in Australia, and a whole lot of things. And it's not just, you know, one sector's issue. It is affecting everyone. Yes, thank you so much.
So
to hear about your living, about your work in the health area and within the community. Health and well-being.
Good morning, everyone. I've already been introduced. My name is Selba Gondoza Luka. I come from a country called Malawi. I'd firstly thank Dr. Mimi. You are an amazing woman. Putting this summit together, I am actually melting. It's my hope that this type of meetings, gatherings, should happen quite often, and I'll be working with you. We need something very quickly with the women and the young people. Now, coming to why I've got the microphone. Has anyone suffered the pain from divorce? If you know anyone or you are, I just want hands up. Divorce? Knowing anyone with mental illness?
Not yet.
Knowing anyone who has lost a child? Knowing anyone who has a child drinking, police coming, then going to prison? Going to court? All those four things, look at me. Of course, my daughter did not go to prison, but going in courts. Why am I standing here? Why am I here? I wanted to commit suicide, but some people like Dr. Mimi, people who listened to you, helped me. Age 50, I was divorced. Lost a baby 2001. Got postnatal depression and got tormented by ex-husband, went into a psychiatric ward. After that, he left and married a younger woman in Malawi, leaving me, age 15, homeless, from a beautiful home to no home, and I had to live with my daughter's boyfriend. In Africa, that's a no-no. But where could I live? I had nowhere to live. Now, I took my pain, the pain I'm saying, and my daughter actually went astray, started drinking, caught police. Then when the man left, we took our pain together and opened an organization called AfriOz Care to help the people in need. Being African and also a mental health clinician, I've worked in all psychiatric hospitals in Melbourne and also in prisons. I know how African people are suffering. If we remain silent and zip up our mouth and not talking about our problems, who is going to help us? So, self-funded organization, no funding at all. I know people think that I've got a lot of money. It's funding coming, it's just now. We started looking after young people. I helped my daughter, and I knew that I could help other people. We started with very few young people. Now the kids we are helping, it's up to 70. Now, what I'm trying to say is, don't hide your problems. Tell the people what you're going through and seek for help. I'm really happy with the lady who just spoke from US.
Yeah, Juanita.
Juanita actually wanted to do something with her own community. Do not hide, look for help. So at AfriOz Care, we look after young people at risk of developing mental illness and their families. These problems, people, they are suffering mental illness silently, as what you have just said. You go to the hospital, they do this, there is no disease in you, but you are suffering there. Because in Africa, mental health is a taboo. We don't talk about it. Yeah. Come in the open, people, and look for help. Yeah. The government would like to help us. So if you hide, you will not get any help. You heard Honorable Bruce Atkinson saying that he regards me as a friend. It's because I went to him. I said, I've started an organization, I don't have money. He said, Selba, work with other people. Again, did you say Juanita, the lady? The global thing she has said, work with other organizations. He told me, if you want to succeed, work with other organizations. So all what I can say is, our own health is very important. You need to speak to people and get some help. And if you want to know more about AfriOz Care, go on our website and come and speak to me. Thank you.
So good morning, everyone.
Tamimi introduced. My name is Desiree Naogbele Ashite, and I would just like to share a bit about my journey so far, and hopefully to inspire the younger African women here. So I came from a background of health. So my mom is a nurse. So growing up, she taught us to wash our hands with soap before eating. A lot of things that I grew up with came from her being a nurse and a midwife. I saw how she interacted with women in our community. People came to her to ask her for advice. So I grew up with an appreciation of health. And I had this interest. I would borrow books about anatomy and just read them myself. So I did a bachelor's in biomedical science because I wanted to become a doctor. Doctor, maybe just added, yeah, it's one of the things you have to do as an African. You know, you either have to be a doctor, lawyer, engineer, So I came from that background, and after my course in biomedical science, I tried a couple of times to get into medical school, but I couldn't. And at the end of my degree, I went to Ghana in 2012 and came back. After my holiday, there was an opportunity for me to do a master's in public health, and I thought, let me see, let me look at the other side of health, because science is very objective. You add this, that, and you have this result, but let me look at the other side. So I decided to do a master's in public health, and what public health did for me was to open my mind to consider health, not only from a clinical perspective, but also from a social, cultural, economic, historic. As Africans, history plays a big part in our health. And I was supposed to do my master's in 2 years, but for some reason, it dragged on. And for me to be here today presenting what I discovered at the end of my research is a testimony of our strength as African women in particular, our agency, how we help each other in times of need. And I'll just like to say a big thank you to the beautiful women who just volunteered their time to help me with my study. So what study did I do? I did a study about vitamin D. Now everyone knows vitamin D is a big problem. In the white mainstream community it is, but even more so in the African community, everyone knows vitamin D is important. Vitamin D is a disease of high prevalence, but no one had asked the why. And why is very important. Day by day, I'm discovering always to ask why. No one had asked why vitamin D was a big problem in the African community. So I decided to do this pioneering study, and it's been a roller coaster of a journey, but I'm glad I did it. I interviewed 30 women. Thank you. I interviewed 30 women from sub-Saharan backgrounds, and I did that specifically because I wanted to ask them what they know about vitamin D, the things that shape their knowledge, their perceptions about vitamin D, and their attitudes towards vitamin D. And what I found among this cohort was everyone knows vitamin D is good. Everyone knows it's good for bone health, it's good for muscle health, but that's where it stops. No one knows that vitamin D is important in immunity. It prevents things like certain cancers, like breast cancer, colon cancer. It's good for the immune system, prevents things like diabetes. It's essential in brain development. There are no conventional roles that vitamin D plays, and no one really knows. So it's kind of like this thing that everyone knows is important, but it's not of high priority because we don't really know how important vitamin D is. Again, I found this perception that, oh, vitamin D is important, but you know, it's not as dangerous as skin cancer. So people often wouldn't go into the sun to get vitamin D. And I would like to encourage you, one take-home message that I would like to encourage everyone is have ownership of your health. Take time to read about things that affect your health. When you go to see the doctor, ask questions. When the doctor says, oh, do a blood test, recommend, say, I would like you to test my vitamin D levels. Take ownership of your health.
Well, thank you very much for that. My name is Nkandu Belt, So I'll be talking a little bit more about what we do in the areas of health and well-being. So yesterday, how many heard me speak yesterday? Okay, so quite a few. So yesterday I was talking about, like, when we are doing our talks at the Center for Leadership and Management, we look at a holistic approach into the health and well-being. My mom was a nutritionist, so growing up, it was a lot of vegetables and a lot of fruit. There was no sugar, and I thought she was mean. And the first time I had Coca-Cola, I was 16, and I was in boarding school, and I got sick. But the thing is, you know, all that stuff would have affected, you know, like sugar apparently affects your brain and your thinking, mm-hmm. and it's actually so addictive, and it's worse than cocaine. Mm-hmm. Yes. So try to eliminate as much sugar as possible. So looking at taking at this holistic approach to health and well-being, we look at Dr. John DeMartini's 7 areas of your life, and we try to empower our youth and our women to take a holistic approach to these 7 areas of your life. So it's divided into the physical, so looking after yourself in a physical way, making sure that, you know, you feel good, you look good, and you at least get the amount of exercise each person needs a day. I think it's about 30 minutes of your walk or so. Mm-hmm. So that is really important because it also helps you to think clearly. Vocation, it's really important that you have a career and do what you love. And we encourage people to do that because it is possible that you can actually prosper from your passion. You talked about, you know, the career paths that our African parents usually want us to follow, and that's because of job security. But I also encourage you, you know, you can be a renegade, but make sure that if you're one, you're a really good one and you succeed at what you do. So don't just be a rebel for the sake of being it. You know, be and succeed at being, you know, being good at what you do. The second part is the mental health. You've heard that, you know, our psychology also affects our physiology. Have you heard of I'll give you a perfect example of myself. One time I was nose bleeding and we couldn't stop it. So we had to go to the hospital. And my husband, who's a medical doctor, could not stop my nose bleeding for 3 hours at home. And when we went to the hospital, they thought it was a case of domestic violence or so. And I was like, no, he would never touch me. Otherwise, you know, he would be like so dead. When we sat down and Eric said to me, it's because of all the stress that you're going through. That's why, you know, it's affecting your physiology. So I had to sort of like step back because I can be a workaholic and, you know, that also affects your mental health and your state of well-being. The other point is being financially independent. And we find that, you know, when a woman is financially independent, the chances of being in a relationship that has, you know, domestic violence are very, very minimal. And it's not only, you know, the physical violence, but also the emotional, mental, and sexual violence. Mm-hmm. So I encourage everyone to look after their financial side of things. And then also balancing up your family life. It's really important to do that. I'm running out of time. And then your spiritual life as well as having a social life. We can talk about this at some point. But then the other thing that I really want to touch on is that in Australia we have the highest incidence of teen suicides as well as New Zealand. And recently I did an interview for my TV show with Heath Ledger's dad, Kim Ledger, and was talking about, you know, that people are not really well educated about the medicine and how to take the medication. Yeah. So it's really important, like what Ms. Mpanda was saying, that, you know, go out there, ask for help, and educate yourself as much as you can, and don't self-medicate.
Thank you. I would like to thank Dr. Mimi to organizing this event successfully. We have learned a lot of it, and I'm really honored and glad to be attending this meeting. Concerning health and well-being, even if I'm not from the health background, I just have a chance to come across with different things regarding the health. from coming to my personal experience, let me give you some background regarding to health issues and well-being of my back to my country. When it comes to our case in Ethiopia, I think most of the time what we are thinking and health issues are very damn expensive. So what we are going to do is our government find it out rather than just treatment of the health, the illness. It's better to be most of 80 or 85% of the disease in Africa, particularly in our case, is preventive. So we have to work. We are devising a strategy and a policy in that regard, and it's really working on preventing
mechanisms. You're rebel for the sake of being, be and succeed at being, being good at what you do. The second part is the mental health. You've heard that, our psychology also affects our physiology. Have you heard of, I'll give a perfect example of myself. One time I was nose bleeding, and we couldn't stop it, so we had to go to the hospital. And my husband, who's a medical doctor, could not stop my nose bleeding for 3 hours at home. And when we went to the hospital, they thought it was a case of domestic violence or so. And I was like, no, he would never touch me, otherwise, he would be like, so dead. But, so when we finally, and then when we sat down and Eric said to me, it's because of all the stress that you're going through, that's why, it's affecting your physiology. So I had to sort of like step back, because I can be a workaholic and, that also affects your mental health and your state of well-being. The other point is being financially independent. And we find that, when a woman is financially independent, the chances of being in a relationship that has, domestic violence are very, very minimal. And it's not only, the physical violence, but also the emotional, mental, and sexual violence. So I encourage everyone to look after their financial side of things, and then also balancing up your family life. It's really important to do that. I'm running out of time. And then your spiritual life, as well as having a social life. We can talk about this at some point. But then the other thing that I really want to touch on is that in Australia, we have the highest incidence of teen suicides, as well as New Zealand. And recently, I did an interview for my TV show with Heath Ledger's dad, Kim Ledger, and he was talking about, that people are not really well educated about the medicine and how to take the medication. So it's really important, like what Mr. Pado was saying, that, go out there, ask for help, and educate yourself as much as you can, and don't self-medicate.
Coming to my personal experience, let me give you some background regarding to health issues and well-being of my back to my country. When it comes to our case, most of the time what we are thinking and health issues are very expensive. So what we are doing is our government find it out rather than treatment of the health, the illness, that's better to be most of 80 or 85% of the disease in our country, particularly in our case, it's preventive. So we have to work. We are devising a strategy and a policy in that regard, and it's really working on preventing mechanisms because, treatment is really all financial burdens. So what we are focusing on is on preventive mechanisms, and the government can just deploy health workers that have some training. So, all right, my time is running out anyway. Thank you very much for listening to me.
introducing health from a type of a cultural perspective, but really giving us in very personal examples, but what generally affects our community specifically. And Mr. Eshetu, this year I had the privilege of having Dr. Tespe from Makerere University. He gave a lecture to our Bachelor of Health Science students at Victoria University, and the lecture was on the Ethiopian healthcare system. So I've got a very good insight of the wonderful work that has happened over in Ethiopia, but unfortunately that work is not being shared to the world because the government has put so much money in building these outreach clinics in some of the most rural areas. If you've been to places like Mekele, it is so hilly and so stony in Ethiopia, yet they've been able to have infrastructure there to stop, you know, to help to reduce maternal mortality ratios, and it is significantly reduced. So I've got a lot of data there, and preventative care is one of the things that is lacking in Africa. But what we bring with us in Australia is that we also bring that mentality of that you only get really sick when you are dying. That's when you go to the hospital. But people don't like to know their diagnosis. They don't want to know the reality of what is happening deep down there. And I think I would like you people to give a few words as well, in about 3 minutes, what you want us to do as individuals, as a community, or as professionals. So whichever one you like to, for 3 minutes, in supporting our people, but what it means, why we should be talking about our healthcare, and why we should be seeking help, even if we are not like dying, or we don't need to drink.
Testing.
I think that's a microphone.
Yes, Mimi, thank you for the question. It's because there is a gap between African-Australian women, in general migrant women, but particularly African-Australian women are less likely to enjoy the benefit of health than the mainstream, and there are research outcomes. Therefore, we need to address it. Thank you.
Oh, what I can share with you is if you are feeling low, difficult to get out of bed, heart beating fast, or parents are arguing in case of young people, or husband and wife fighting, all these things, they make your brain think in a different way. There's a neurotransmitter called serotonin. When it goes down, that's when you have depression. Don't wait for that time. Do other things. Reach out to other people. Talk to people you trust. Go for a walk. Go to the doctor. I always go to my GP, check my blood. When you do that, you cannot fall sick. You can fall sick, but things cannot become worse. So look after yourselves. You cannot help other people if you are not feeling well. So that's what I can encourage you. And for mental health, please talk about it. It's no time to hide about depression. Because when it's there, when you start on medication, it's very difficult to come out of medication. So look after yourselves.
Okay, so to add to that, I would just like to say again, to highlight how the need for us to take ownership of our health. We spend time on Facebook, I'm guilty of it myself, but we really need to take time to really read about things that affect our health. Because when you look in the mainstream, things are said to fit the mainstream. For example, the Sun Safe message, it's not really culturally tailored to fit the different demographics. You have to take time to educate yourself. And when you do, share it amongst each other. Because from our background, storytelling and sharing our experiences, it really hits a nerve when you share with your fellow sister, you know, your children, share the information around in your networks and empower yourselves. And that's how we can learn from each other and, you know, solve these problems that we continuously face. We are the ones that are able to solve our own problems. So yeah, that's what I'd like to add.
Thank you. When I was growing up, I used to be told, you know, you're 100% responsible for your actions. And each and every one of us is 100% responsible for our own actions and for looking after our own health. So when it comes to physical and mental health, it's really important to talk about it and always seek help. And also to reduce the stigma that's attached with mental health. I think a lot of people are working in that space and it's been really reduced. So seek help, and that would be like my number one recommendation. We talk about it, yeah.
What I do in this point is, I think women are key role players in the health and well-being. So I think we are just educating them, give them priority on this regard, especially I'm just going to focus on, rather than treatment, it's better to focus on preventive mechanisms. Are that really the best way and really cost-wise? We can afford, because it costs us a lot for good for treatments, you know? So it's better to not addicting to the GP, it's better to focus on preventive mechanisms. That's what.
Thank you to the panelists, and now we're going to open the questions to the floor. Dr. Berhan is here.
I'd like to say first thank you, but the elephant in the room, the cultural barriers that our community face is not just visiting a doctor. In this country, doctors confront the patient. They say you will die in 6 months, and it's hard to swallow. Most of our community members, they go overseas. So how do we get culturally to try to balance our understanding health and confronting issues that you will die in 6 months, or you will die in 2 years, or something to that effect, where we are not used to it? You go to serve world doctors, even if you are going to die tomorrow, they tell you, "Ah, well, you're okay." So psychologically, you feel you are moving. So that cultural component is the most important for me, the elephant in the room. What is being said scientifically is fact, but we are not in science. We are in culture. We are a little bit out of that equation and facing new culture. So how can we address that, or how can we bring our communities, and especially always I ear to the side where majority refugees and humanitarian immigrants who are not educated, we expect them in this sort of top level of understanding. So I would appreciate if you could consider putting that view into your equation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Burhan, for your question. I can actually tell you a living experience, two living experiences. When I was mentally ill, I was told I would never get any better, but it was a situation of crisis because my daughter died. So I turned to the church and the other people, they helped me, I'm better, I'm here, number one. Then again, in 2006, I had liver complications. I was told they wanted biopsy, they wanted this, and I was given 2 weeks to die. I'm here. That was 2016. I turned to people for prayers. People helped me with prayers. I changed the way I was eating. I'm here today. So, living proof.
There is a new policy, I think, that's encouraging to have that cultural approach, and also people who are affected, if they can actually be the leader in the area. For example, recently there was a project about vaccination, the new vaccination for teenagers, and that was initiated by Alimati University, and we try to take that role of leadership and lead the project, but unfortunately there was still a lot of limitations. So we all need to be really active in all areas, in policy areas, and when there is a policy of this, we need to be very active and get involved and take that leadership, because people who are affected know best how to deal with the issue and approach it in culturally appropriate method.
Great.
Just
just to add on, you know, like the social inclusion, like you say you went to church and a lot of other social groups, it's really important to make sure that you are not isolated, because once you do that, things actually become worse. So reaching out to our communities, and then also talking about what is culture and what is tradition. It is something that we human beings have actually constructed. So it's something that we can also reconstruct to make sure that, you know, everything that we're doing, it's, you know, it's balancing and it's fitting our current situations.
Affirming what you say, and Dr. Berger, in terms of trust and the cultural appropriateness, I think one of the things that we suffer from, and somebody talked about, that our health is affected by our history, or our history affects our health. And when you think about the distrust of healthcare and providers in the African context, you just need to take a step back and look at African Americans and the syphilis trials with the Tuskegee syphilis trial, where people, living people, were tested, you know, to see the effect of tertiary syphilis in them. And you know, that is an example. How do you go back to that community to get them to trust you as a healthcare provider? So all of those things come into play, but I think it was a great question. Thank you. Where's the mic?
As a parent, what is one of the most difficult things you've been through, and how can you affect your
health? As a parent, what is the most difficult thing you've been through, and how did it affect your health?
So we, as we have got children, so we have just properly, you know, addressing the maintaining, we have to give them the right nutrition, we have to follow their health conditions, they just like teaching them how to work from the mind, basic health, family health, washing of hands, and getting the right nutrition. So I think once this one is really affecting the health, if the child or one of the member of the family is, you know, gets sick, we have just really, it has got its own burden, like financially, we have to take them, our time is very crucial, but we are just losing our job and we are attending to hospital. All these stuffs, and we have just give them more focus on the health issues. In order to, you know, leading our family in proper channel, unless we are not doing, give them more and more emphasis on health issues, and I think continue to have a way and leading our well-being of our families in proper ways and getting best out of it. So I think health is very crucial issues for a family, and we have just given them, you know,
what a good answer. I'll answer very quickly. You young people, you cause a lot of problems. Because you have got rights. Rights without responsibilities are nothing. You can follow the rights, but you have to take responsibility. Yeah. I suffered a lot because my daughter, as soon as we came here, Mom, I can't wash dishes, I can't do this, I cannot do this. All these things you do, young people, they cause depression. Depression causes diabetes, and then you have degenerative diseases. We will die very quickly before.
They took us to a funeral guest. And I said, why are they bringing me to the funeral place? That's not attractive. Anyway, we were many, and we've seen that Professor Lagap, he died since he was 6 months old. She died when she was 3 years. How can a person is a professor and he died after 6 months old? We weren't really tolerant to finish the visit. And we keep on asking and shouting for the guy. And they said in their culture, they would consider someone is alive when he or she contributes to their backbone. That is a starting point. So considering that criteria, I'm still young. A training, allow me to speak a little bit.
Yes, please.
She took me for a training to Kenya, and which I don't know the topic of the training, because I am a good friend of her, I have to respect her, I joined her. And the title of the topic says, journey, the journey training. And in African context, journey is either we have to fly like here 24 hours, or to drive. That's what I know. What's journey? You'll see. And she said, really, the journey is that you have to make journey inside with yourself. Mm-hmm. And what's happening with this panelist is that we have to make journey inside from today. That's why the outcome of this kind of meeting, there is no reason that we have to sleep so many hours, because from the title, and when Dr. Mimi, wow, I have to go. If I contribute a drop, that we really help the young ladies, African ladies that live in Australia. I feel like I would contribute in trouble. I would at least to pass a message, they have to make journey inside and ask themselves, who am I? Am I owning my health? What I am doing? Am I relevant? Am I really giving respect to myself? Am I valuing myself? Do I feel I'm an expensive generation? Because Africa needs you. Historically, Africa is known in on the TVs. News from the dark continent. Don't miss out, because history. The second time, it becomes like news from the crisis continent, the conflict continent. Now, it becomes Africa, a place for marketing. We have reached at that stage, which means you are very much, you are the crema of crema, had access to come here where there are a lot of education and health challenges addressing you can address. There are many health questions we have no access to be examined in Africa because of lack of some technologies, but you are here. So if you own your health, if you value yourself, if you own yourself and educate, try to educate yourself. Why are we really putting ourselves, our young people are immediately on crisis than on the success of? Because we don't have mentoring. Mentoring, who's going to be a mentor? Like Dr. Mimri and others try to be a mentor for all of us. So start feeling, I don't believe that the young generations are the problem causers, I'm sorry. I really consider the young generations are the victims. And then, the intergenerational conflict, we have to sit down, we have to give respect to our parents, we have to listen to our young generation, and consider our young generations are the victims, because we are in a different generation, and then parents have also to build their capacity on how to communicate with kids, and the kids have also to respect and learn the generation and the value and the culture of their identity. Don't lose your identity. Stand on the floor, start thinking and believing that you are African.
That's it.
academic.
How much are you integrating yourself?
Okay.
How much are you working together? I didn't see also developmental anthropologists and also community workers. How much are you really collaborating? And what would be, with due respect and with due expectations that we have to do something together, how much are we really, I can understand this is inauguration, it's a celebration time. Is there any follow-up action planning? An inclusive action planning and participatory planning in the different age groups and so on. Thank you so much.
Wow.
Thank you to Professor Fentin. Does it justify why she is here? So, thank you so much. Can we go time for the comments? Reflect on this. We have to go through a journey in ourselves. Intergenerational conflict. We need to think about it. It is a two-way street.
Yes.
So I think those are two key things that came out of that is what I gathered. We must really reflect and we must listen to the others and we must work together, which is something. So I think those are some of the four key things that I heard. So we should make sure that this comes through in our recommendations for the summit and what we're gonna do post it. So we've got one more question and then we're going to close this panel because we're eating into the lunch time. I think Amanda, you've got the microphone that side. Thank you.
My question is, what advice do you give to children? I'll use us. So it's women, the youth, we have the men also, even maybe the elderly. We live in a context that is quite challenging in terms of discrimination. And we live with it. It's upon our minds every day. We meet that in the workplace, along the streets, anywhere you go. Personally, I have had that professional, of course, advice from counselors, psychologists. That's one thing that I have failed to come up with a definite answer or help itself. There is stress or anxiety, depression related to discrimination just because of the context we are in. It comes in, it goes, it comes back. What advice do you have for me and my fellow brethren? Thank you.
I'm sorry that you've had to experience that, but a lot of the people that I work with, they actually have experienced what you've experienced. And you've heard of the Nelson Mandela inaugural speech that he made when he became president. And he said that our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are capable, we are powerful beyond measure, and it is our light, not our darkness, that we are most frightened of. I would encourage each and every one of you to actually go and read that poem. The way you see yourself is the way the world is going to see you. So it's really important that you value yourself and never ever put anyone on a pedestal. I was working in a job as a broadcaster at a radio station, and the manager was putting up all many things of what I should be doing and what I shouldn't, to the extent where he actually went and painted the studio black.
Oh, really?
So I walk into the studio and there's a fresh smell of paint and it's black. And I went to him and I was like, you know what, George, I'm not gonna put up with you on this. So I had to stand my ground, you know, and I had the risk of losing my job. And after a few months, I decided to quit and set up my own organization. But the question is, what is the hidden benefit of what you are going through? Because there's always a hidden blessing in everything that we experience.
What I can say, we cannot run away from discrimination. People discriminate us, whether we want it or not. What we have to do is to stand up for ourselves, but in a sensible way. Because if you stand up yourself maybe a little bit higher, they are going to take that as something that you have done something wrong. If it's a job, do it right. If maybe it's at school, do it right. And if you see that this discrimination is actually really hard for you, seek for help. There are anti-discrimination laws. Sometimes people say if they don't work, then please believe yourself. No one has died from discrimination. Maybe some have, but do the best what you can do for yourself.
So thank you for that comment. So before we wrap up for this session, I'm going to ask the panelists in maybe 10 to 20 seconds, just give one last message that you want to share with our audience. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks again. My message is inform yourself, know what your rights are, stay connected, and always be ready to give. Thank you.
Because I work with young people, all what I can say is work with your parents, and parents work with your children. Make them your friends. When you have a friend, you cannot think bad about them, but you protect them. So you'll be living in a protected environment. Thank you.
My message to everyone is to take ownership of your health. And when I say ownership, knowing and also in your interaction with healthcare professionals, and it comes back to the discrimination, don't be afraid to challenge. Don't be afraid to say, doctor, why? What are my options? Do you mind doing this, that? You know, it's not all right to just accept things just the way they are. Question things. Value yourself enough to question things and demand the best. This is our country too. This is our country too.
Any area of our lives that we don't empower, somebody else is going to overpower us. And it's very important that you're empowered in all areas of your life. We come from a land of kings and queens.
Yes.
And we really need to embody that and show it. You are powerful.
My message is don't pick up everything what you get, especially for young Africans and women. Because you are living in a country, everything is get asked easily. So you have to be selective and rational and wise. So I think you have been, black is beautiful. So you have to be champion and you are being the best of best and working hard in order to be the first. Always you have to work and be the best out of this environment.
To the panel, and my one message will be just be the leader that you want to see in others. So can we put our hands together for everyone?